Hey guys, welcome. This is Sundance. Welcome to the next in the series of the Wondernines. As you'll remember from the first one, the Browning High Power, we're doing a review of the pistols that I think fall into the category of Wondernines. Those icons of pistol design that prove to be high capacity 9mm pistols that transitioned us from revolvers and single stack pistols into the high capacity world, starting with the Browning High Power. The series will continue through a number of guns that I've identified as being those designs that have stood the test of time and those pistols that have become legendary. And in the series of Wondernines, I'm going to include a gun that had a certain mystique here in the United States for quite a while because you couldn't get them here. There was a little bit of a black market for a while for the CZ-75. Hey guys, welcome to the tabletop of the next gun in the series of the Wondernines. This one is the CZ-75, as we discussed in commentary. This, if you'll take a minute, is a strikingly beautiful gun. This one happens to be an all stainless steel. The originals, of course, were in a very nice, rich blue steel. But now they're available in stainless, which to me makes them all the more attractive. This is a solid steel gun, like I said, which means it's a heavy, solid gun, and it's not a lightweight pistol. It's a service gun, probably not for concealed carry. CZ, however, does make several variants now, including some shortened versions and some polymer-framed pistols, essentially with the same design. So the CZ-75 being the classic from, let's think about it for a minute, 1975, would be in this format here, not counting their more current variants. You couldn't get these very well in the United States in the late 70s. That created quite a mystique. There was something mysterious about the ever elusive and almost legendary CZ-75 pistol. Folks in the United States and the law enforcement kept hearing about this great pistol over in Europe, but they couldn't get their hands on them. Those that were available were almost in black market prices, very expensive. Now at some point, and I don't remember when, my research doesn't really go that far, but these were started to come in by importation. Of course, the price came down then, and the guns became more available. And they have definitely withstood the test of their own reputation. They have been every bit as good as what the mystique and legend of the CZ-75 established. It's a great pistol design. So great, in fact, that aside from the Browning High Power and perhaps the 1911, this gun is cloned throughout the world as much as anybody else, and you know, more so than anybody but the High Power in the 1911, I guess is what I'm trying to say. The Italian firm of Tonfaglio, the EA Witness, the Jericho pistols, and more recently the Armalite pistols are all clones, copies, variants, some would say improvements, but I think that's more of a marketing statement. But they're all variants of this CZ-75 original design. Some of the neat things about the CZ-75, First of all, it can be, in terms of the battery of arms, it can be operated as a single action pistol or a double action pistol. You can cock the hammer back and put this into safe and carry it as a cocked and locked single action pistol, and it will go off safe and fire and function just like a single action 1911 or Browning high power. I can't imagine anybody watching this video has any confusion about single action versus double action, but if you do, you can see one of my follow-up videos on that very thing. Otherwise, this gun can be operated in double action mode, which means long, heavy, and by the way, in a CZ, it is very long and very heavy. first trigger pull, which as you're pulling, the hammer's going back until it comes forward and fires. That is a heavy double action pull. The subsequent shots are not long and heavy, but the first one is, frankly, atrocious. However, the gun is accurate. It seems to be inherently accurate, both my sample and the reputation of the CZs. And part of that may be, I don't know if it's true or not, but part of it may be this part of the design. And if you look here, I'll let my camera focus for you a little bit, you'll see that the slide rides inside the frame. You see right there, the slide's riding all the way along the frame. Most pistols, other European designs and American designs, have the slide sitting outboard of the frame and usually making contact at a rear point, and a front point. But in this particular design, the frame is making contact with the slide throughout the length of where the contact is, from this cutout all the way to the rear. And it's on the inside of the frame instead of the outside. So the theory has been, I don't know if this is true or not, but the accuracy of this particular gun stems from that, at least in part, by that part of the design. That frame to slide contact. Don't know if it's true or not. It gives you less to grab a hold of, but it's never seemed to have been a problem for me. You do notice it as you reach to pull the slide back, but of course that's just a chamber the first round. Thereafter, the battery of arms on the gun doesn't require you to touch the slide at all, so it's really a non-issue. It does feel a little funny though when you're first pulling the slide back for a chambering. That is a beautiful gun. It's a classic. Fits perfectly within the parameters of our discussion of the great Wondernine pistols.
CZ-75.